grafted into the family of God. Lord, we thank you for the temporal country you've blessed us with to live here in the United States. We thank you for the religious freedoms that have been afforded us. And while we recognize that the times where the lamb-like beast no longer speaks as a lamb, we understand that soon it will speak as a dragon. And yet in these relative times of peace that remain, few though they be, you call us to an experience with you and your word that will afford us a faith that will be unshakable in the face of anything and everything. So please, Lord, in this portion of the service, I ask that your words would speak through me, and we would leave this place encouraged in our faith and determined to follow your word ever closer so that we can grow a stronger faith even still. So please, Lord, accompany my efforts with the Holy Spirit's infilling, both in my heart and in the hearts of the hearers. For thy glory, we pray this, Jesus. Amen. Good morning, church family. It's good to be in the house of God. I do want to draw your attention. I think everybody knows what has taken place this week in regards to Dee Lampson's passing. We have lost a dear brother in Christ in Dee Lampson going to sleep in Jesus. And we will be celebrating his life March 25th. And the details of that time, it'll be in the afternoon here at Huntsville Central. Stay tuned, we'll get you those details. But please remember Kathy and the family in your prayers. So I want to offer up an apology to our bulletin secretary. I don't know that it's a heartfelt apology, but it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek apology. I changed my sermon 3 times this week.
I made your apologies online today.
Thank you. And those who were leading out in music, thank you for bearing with me. You know, the Lord gave me another sermon, at least I thought, and then as I was preparing that, I got a whole nother message. And so you're getting the third go around. So the title of the message today is Stewards of God's Resources. Stewards of God's Resources. Today I'm going to talk to you about what the Bible says about money management. And again, the sermon title is Stewards of God's Resources. Another working title could be Biblical Principles of Money Management. Okay? So the Bible has a lot to say about money. And so does our society. You know, God has a plan for your money. Did you know that? But not only does God have a plan for your money, but Satan has a plan for your money as well. Did you know that? First, let's begin with the problem, okay? Because it's nice to begin with the problem. That way you can end with the solution, right? You build the tension with the problem. Hopefully the application happens where you apply it to your own life. And then hopefully, by God's grace, we're able to offer what the scripture gives in a way of the aha moment, the solution. So first, let's begin with the problem. Satan's plan for your money is, number one, if you're taking notes, Satan's plan for your money is materialism. Materialism. You know, materialism plays a great part in the great controversy. Do you know that? It does. If we indulge materialism, we will become more and more covetous. Now, as we become more and more covetous, we will become more and more selfish. Now, this is not unique to capitalism in the West. I have had the opportunity to be in a communist country. And I have found that while you and I can procure items and material goods easily, and if you can't afford the retail stores, you can always go to the thrift store because people have so much stuff that the thrift store in a nice big city like this or middle-sized city like this is quite nice. And so if you can't afford the retail stores or the sales, you can always go to the thrift stores and buy stuff that you really don't need. But that's not unique to capitalism in the West, where we buy things not because we need them, but because we just want them. And sometimes we don't even know why we want them. We just are in the habit of buying more things. I had the opportunity to go to Cuba, and I want to tell you that Karl Marx was wrong. Karl Marx had the idea that if you take a bunch of people and you put them in a certain environment, that that will take care of selfishness. Not true. Because selfishness is a matter of the heart. Let me ask you, can any man or any circumstance or any philosophical construct change a person's heart? Outside the Bible? No. I submit to you that the only thing that can change sinful man's heart is Jesus Christ and a thus saith the Lord. The only means whereby you and I can be changed. I want to ask you to raise your hands, but let's just pretend that I were. Don't raise your hands. Anybody here selfish? Anybody here been convicted that they have a problem with being covetous? You know, the Bible calls it idolatry. You don't have to go and worship at a Buddha, or you don't have to go and worship Baal to be an idolater. Just want things that aren't yours. It brings it a lot closer to home, doesn't it? At any rate, to continue to develop the problem, when covetousness and selfishness grows in a person's heart, a love for material goods ends up replacing love for God and love for other people. It seems quite reasonable, doesn't it? If you love material goods and you're constantly coveting and wanting more and more and more, and you become more and more selfish, then whether we realize it or not, there is a nature to fallen man that goes like this. If Jesus doesn't have the heart, then Satan and his devices will. It's quite simple. Either Jesus has the heart or he doesn't. And if Jesus doesn't have the heart, Satan has the heart. And he'll have people chase after material goods to fill that hole in their heart. And he'll have them so induced and calculatedly full of covetousness and addicted to more and more and more. And they'll be so self-indulgent, so self-centered, so living for self, and can't understand why they're so miserable. Meanwhile, the love of God, the love for God, the love of others, the love for others diminishes, disappears. The Bible uses language like this: in the end, the love of many will wax cold because iniquity abounds. Do we live in a world today where the love of people's hearts is growing cold? Matthew 6, verse 21. If you're taking notes, we won't take time to turn there, but I'm going to read off my notes for sake of time. Matthew 6, 21, Jesus says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." So the question we want to ask ourselves is, what do we treasure? I had the privilege of teaching the youth class today, and I asked them the question, who here wants to be rich? Who here wants to make a lot of money? I won't share with you what they told me, but it very much was similar to my experience at 17, 18, 19. I'm 42 now, and I'm starting to get wheels on this concept, but it's been slow going, and I'm so glad that the Lord is patient. Oh. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. When a person's heart becomes full of love for material goods, they naturally develop a love for money. Now, why is that? Because they want to have the ability to purchase more of whatever material goods they desire. And with every purchase, there is, albeit a passing thrill that ensues, but the emphasis on passing, Yes, there is a thrill that ensues, but ultimately, they never find satisfaction in their materialistic pursuits. Is that true? It has been in my own life and in my own observation of others. Proverbs 27, verse 20. Again, we won't take time to turn there, but if you're taking notes or you're listening to this on YouTube, you can take notes. Proverbs 27, verse 20. Hell and destruction are never full, so the eyes of man are never satisfied. Constantly wanting something else. I want a new car. Why? Your car runs good. It's nice. It's respectable. Well, I don't know. I want a new car. Why? I want new shoes. Why? You have a closet full of shoes. They all fit you fine and they're comfortable. I don't know. I want new shoes. And so on. The eyes of man, and we could add woman, are never satisfied. True? The Bible, yes, it's true. And so the more money a person has, the more they think and feel secure. But let me ask you a question. In what do they feel secure? I visited many a dying person at their deathbed. Can money secure health? Can money buy you one more day? No, it cannot. I've counseled, had the privilege to counsel many couples. Can money secure a happy home, a happy marriage? I don't think I heard as many no's on that one. Now, let's be clear. God would have us to live within our means. Amen? It is good to have a budget, right? This thing seems a little hot. It is good to have a budget. It is good to live within our means, amen? I've sadly watched friends and family members give up their faith in God and in the Bible. Let me ask you, can money secure a person's faith in God and His Word? No. I've mediated between hostile family members and hostile church members. You never would have thought that they were Christians. Can money secure healthy relationships? No, instead, oftentimes, money is the very means whereby relationships are destroyed. True? If not, just wait for a wealthy family member to die. I've witnessed a world church that is so divided, so splintered, so cut up in so many pieces, in desperate need of the Holy Spirit and revival and unity. Let me ask you, can money secure you and the church that we beloved, the Holy Spirit? No, it can't. Let me ask you, will money finish the work? Yes and no? You know, there was a man by the name of Simon Magus. You heard about him, the book of Acts. He was so impressed by the disciples being able to lay on hands to the people in Samaria, I believe it was, and Peter and John were laying on the hands of people and baptizing them in the name of the Holy Spirit. They had already been baptized in water baptism, but they hadn't received the baptism of the Holy Spirit yet. John and Peter baptized them in the Holy Spirit by laying hands on them. Simon Magus was so impressed, so amazed. Wow, how did you do that? I want to do that. How much money? Give me that ability to peddle the Holy Spirit. How much money? What's the price? And of course, he was rebuked. Peter said, "Your money die with you, Simon." No? So what is it that a person feels secure in whenever they have so much money? Is it a true security? Is it a heavenly security? Or is it a security that they can go out and buy more material goods? The devil has a plan for your money. It's called materialism. And he wants to so program you to have so many artificial needs that you, in the name of need, you will spend your whole life pursuing material goods, only to find yourself desperately empty, longing for something better. And yet it's bizarre. Quite frankly, it is absolutely ridiculous that from the cradle to the grave, we are tempted to make our focus money. Our young are encouraged to get an education. An education. I didn't say a good one. Praise God for our school. But an education, not so much to develop and grow Christian character, but in order to get a job that makes a lot of money. Ask a group of young people sometime. Do your own survey. Go around and ask people, would you like to make a lot of money? Why? Tell me about it. That was my ambition. I had a goal. I had a whole thing where I was going to be a millionaire by the time I was 30 years old. Now, $1 million today doesn't buy you what it did in the early 90s, in late 80s. But I had I was going to do this, and this. And by then, back in those days, mutual funds were getting 10% a year yield. Can you imagine? That's just wild. And so I was like, I'll make this much money. I'll make my golden goose, and then I'll draw 10% interest every year. And I'll just, I'll live in a comfortable tax bracket and just relax. Go travel. Spend a whole life of self-indulgent traveling. Praise God, I didn't stay there with my philosophy construct at the age of 18. The focus, the devil would love for us to have the wrong focus. That money will offer us security. Yeah, it'll offer you security. It'll offer you security to buy more stuff, materialism. That's all it'll offer you. Notice with me what Paul says in 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of how much evil? All evil. Which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. How many sorrows? Many sorrows. I have some friends that are filthy rich. I mean rich beyond anything. Just filthy rich. And they are some of the most unhappy people. My age, working on their second, third marriage. Kids with multiple spouses. They're unhappy. Why? Because, and now I'm not beating anybody up here that's been your experience, because we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Let's be clear. I'm not beating anybody up here. But no one here got married and made their vows at the altar with the ambition of one day I'm gonna leave my spouse and I'm gonna, break my child's heart. No one here had that ambition. Praise God, there's healing and redemption in Jesus Christ. I'm a product of divorce. My parents didn't have that ambition. It took me time. I had to grow and the Lord had to deal with me and bring me out of some issues where I was resentful. Aren't you glad that God's in the business of healing and restoration? I have these friends that are very wealthy, and that was their ambition, and they got it. You know, whatever you really go for in life, you'll get it more than likely. You might have to sell your principles, but you'll get what you're after. But you're going to pierce yourself through with many sorrows if your ambition in life is to make a lot of money and run after the money. Yeah, you'll be secure. Secure in your ability to buy more stuff, but you won't be secure in joy and peace. You won't be secure in Jesus. Listen to me, young people, old people. It's the truth. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which some have coveted after. They have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. And so, it's interesting to consider that the love of money, in order to buy more material goods, will end up being a central issue in the close of Earth's history. At the very end of time, you know what the Bible says will be a central issue? Revelation 13, verses 16 through 18. And he, that's another study. Well, I'll tell you who the he is in another study. You want to talk to me afterwards? Go ahead. But he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, so the rich don't get out on this one, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And don't miss this, that no man might buy or sell save he have the mark, or the mark of the beast, the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that have understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of man, and his number is 666. So the central issue at the close of time, at the close of Earth's history, will include this ability to buy material goods. And if you follow Satan's plan for your money and your ambition in life is to make a lot of money and you have a love of money in your heart, you'll have a bunch of stuff that rusts out and you have to eventually take it to the thrift stores and then someone like me will buy some of it. But you will have a bunch of stuff that, you know, you'll wonder, where did all the money go? What, you know, people are going to constantly be coming to you with their hand out. Not their hand out, but with their hands open, you know, help me. And then at the very end of time, if you become preconditioned that this is your focus, materialism, 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 then the devil's going to come along and he's like, hey, look, you want to keep buying and selling? You enjoy that, don't you? Well, then you need to do this, this, and this. You need to compromise here. You need to do this. If you want to keep buying and selling, if you like that whole materialism gig, this is what you have to do to keep on keeping on. Satan offers mankind all sorts of inducements to lead people to distrust God and to lead people to break God's law, to sin. We've already looked at his inducements of materialism and the love of money in consistent fashion. Satan will ratchet things up at the end of time. And his ultimate inducement will be, at the end of time, compromise, and you'll be able to keep buying and selling. Satan has a plan for your money. Materialism. As Seventh-day Adventists, we know that the mark of the beast, what it's going to be. We understand that Satan is going to have a worldwide coalition that will legislate law that requires men and women to break God's law. In other words, Satan is going to say, it's okay to disobey God's law. It's okay to break the Sabbath. Follow me and I will provide for you and your family. I'll make it possible for you to buy and sell so you can put food into your children's mouth. Surely God would understand. Surely God has something in his book that deals with situational ethics. Certainly there's some way that we can circumvent this whole rigid keep the Sabbath day holy. You and I live in a culture of compromise. Let it not be so with us. So while Satan is offering his inducements, and while he will ultimately offer up his big inducement, the ability to buy and sell, I'd like us to notice the solution that God has. God offers us up a solution. God offers us not inducements, but God instead offers us himself. God offers us not only himself, but he offers us his son. Not only does he offer us his son, but he offers us his very word, his character, his integrity, his honesty. He says you can stand on it. You can build a life on it. God offers us his promise. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, how inclusive is that? That whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Romans 8:32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If I were to bring any one of my three girls up here and offer any one of them to you, which I wouldn't, but if I were, let's say I had the love of the Father, okay? God's working on me. I don't think he'll ever ask me to do that, but praise God, he did it for us. If I were to offer you one of my children, I've already given you my best gift. Should you feel sheepish and come to me like, hey, can I have a stick of gum? I feel really, really bad for asking you, can I have this stick of gum? Look, I already gave you my child. You know, sometimes we approach God with kind of this like timidity, like, oh, you know, Lord, the Father already gave us Jesus. How much more will he freely give us all things that we need? And yet, why is it that our confidence in the Word of God oftentimes is so languid in this culture we live in? I'll tell you why. The devil's got a plan for your money and your heart. And he's trying to induce you and our young to chase after money, to chase after a love of money. And so all of a sudden, the greatest ambition is not to know Jesus, to know his word, to have his character. All of a sudden, the greatest ambition becomes, how much money do you make? Oh, you make that much money? Wow. Well, you're a person of influence. I might just listen to you more. What else does Jesus offer us besides his son? He offers us this wonderful promise in Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply how much of your need? All your need, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. How much need will God supply you? Everything. What's your need this morning? God will supply it. Go to his word and hold on to those promises. This promise in Philippians 4:19 is one of my favorites. I have held on to this promise. I have talked to the Lord. I've wrestled with the Lord. Lord, you said you would provide for me my every need. I can remember having $12,000 in the bank. That was a record. $12,000 in the bank. I had $52,000 in student loan debt. Me and Jody combined, we got married and we combined our debt and we were at a major deficit financially. Had love financially. And the Lord had already given me an experience where I had learned to trust in the Word of God. I was about a five-year-old Christian. I just graduated my undergrad, had my undergrad degree in theology. I was ready to take the world by storm. Actually, about 7 years into it. And we went up to the seminary. Honey, you remember this. Had $12,000 in the bank, and I calculated everything, and you know how I did my budget? I immediately, at the very top, I said 10% tithe. 10% tithe, I'm just being open with you, 10% tithe, 5% offering. The Lord's convicted me to do more with offering now, but 10% tithe, 5% offering. That was my budget. And then I went down and I did rent, electric bill, you know, cell phone. That's kind of an artificial need, really. But anyway, cell phone, gasoline, insurance on the car, maybe a little bit aside if you need repairs for the car. I just went down the list. You know, Jody and I can have, what, we can have a little bit of money every month, you know, to maybe go out and buy a sandwich, you know, grocery bill, or, you know, grocery bill. And I came, and it was pretty slim. It was tight. It was austere. It was. But God provided. But here's the thing. I came to the end of it, and Carolina Conference had sponsored me to go to the seminary. I had about $1,500 a month. Praise God. But I did all my calculations, and Jody was going to finish her nursing degree at Andrews. And we did all the math, and I said, Jody, we're going to be short $1,000 every month. Huh? Oh, yeah. We were going to be short $1,000 a month. And I didn't want to go into any more debt. $52,000 is enough to start upside down in a marriage, right? Listen closely, young people who are about to go to college or you're in college. Listen closely. Because according to your faith, be it unto you. If you lack the vision of God's word, then you'll do like I did in my undergrad degree and you'll just go into debt. But I'm about to give you a special key. God's about to give you a special key. If you'll grab hold of this, it'll mean something powerful. According to your faith, be it unto you. Well, at this time, I had developed a faith. God had developed a faith in me to trust in his word. I get up there to Andrews. Jody and I make our list. We need $1,000 a month to break even. Where is it going to come from? I do the math. You know, I'm not a great mathematician, but I understand we're going to be at Andrews for about 36 months. It'll take about that for me to finish my seminary degree. Jody's going to finish her nursing degree. 36 months, 3 years. I need $1,000 a month. How long is my $12,000 going to last? How long is my net, my safety net, going to last? A year. So where's the other 2 years going to come from? Either way you turn it, any way you look at it, I didn't have enough money. It was beyond my ability. I was looking at jobs. You know, where can I get the job? I could sweep the floors at the grocery store. I did that in the mornings. My morning class was a bear. I was so tired. At any rate, I told Jody, I said, honey, this is where we're at. The Lord will provide. The Bible says he doesn't, it's good not to go into debt. Spirit of prophecy says, you know, it's good not to go into debt. I don't think the Lord wants us to go into any more debt with schooling. I don't. $52,000 is a lot of debt. She says, okay, do what you think's best. I took all $12,000 out of savings, and I'm a fiscal conservative. This was very rash for me to do, but I'd seen the Lord work. I took all $12,000 out of savings and I put it to student loans, which to most people would be like crazy. Like, what are you doing? Like, your student loans are deferred. You don't even have to pay monthly payments on them. That was not very bright. There's human wisdom and then there's God's wisdom. And I was convicted. You don't have enough money anyways. So go ahead and take away the safety net. I'd seen the Lord work. I took $12,000 out. I think we paid for our first month of rent. We paid for Jody to get in school, and we took all the rest and we just put student loan debt. I think we knocked it down to like 40,000, 41,000. I can't remember. But I was like, oh, it was nice to see the number come down a little bit. But then I was like, okay, we don't have anything to, okay, where is this going to come from? Well, I was praying, and I was holding on to one of my favorite promises. But my God shall supply how much of your need? All your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. God has already given us Jesus. How much more will he freely give us all things that we need? And so I laid it out there. Yeah, brother. I laid it out to the Lord. Lord, you know what I need. I'm putting first things first. Tithe, Lord. I'm working it into the budget. First thing that comes off my list is tithe. I don't deal any money out in a month before returning tithe, first thing to God Almighty. That's where it goes. Tithe and offering, first thing, boom, off the top, boom. That's what I do. I get a phone call. I run into an old friend at the seminary, and he says, Jeff, what are you, you're here? And I'm like, yeah. I used to be the dean of the Thousand Missionary Movement. He was one of my students. Jeff, I go to church in Chicago. Will you come and preach one Sabbath? I said, sure. I go over there. It's a Korean-American church. I get up and I preach. I really felt like my preaching that Sabbath was about like my interview was here. It was not, I didn't think it was stellar. It was like, well. But you know, you never know. The Lord does things in spite of yourself. Praise God. It's not about us, right? And so I get off the pulpit. I come down to the back. They're shaking my hand at the door. And one of the elders comes up to me and says, we want you to be our pastor. I said, excuse me? He said, we're planting a church here. This is a church plant. And we just started this, and we want you to come in here and train us and help us to do outreach, and we want you to be our pastor. I said, really? I'm at the seminary. You can drive over on the weekends. I said, well, yeah, I could do that. He said, will you do it? I said, well, let me pray about it. Give me a few days. I prayed about it for 3 days. I call him back, and I talked to him earlier this week, actually, Elder Danny, or last week, and he said, I told him, I said, listen, brother, I would love to come out there and help. It would, in fact, I love hands-on. Books are okay, but if I took 3 years of just nothing but theological, you know, book stuff, it would drive me bananas. But if I can get my hands on to do local work in the local church, I would love it. He said, great. He said, can we give you a little bit of help? And I said, well, no, I mean, you don't have to worry about that. And I was thinking they were going to offer me gas money, right? You know, gas was a little more expensive, I think, right then. It wouldn't quite be $4 yet a gallon, but it was going that direction. And I said, that's up to you guys. He said, can we give you $1,000 a month? And I said, excuse me? And tears were like welling up in my eyes. I said, I was going to do it for the gas money. He said, no. No. $1,000 isn't much, but we want to help you. We want to help you. And I'm just, tears are like, you know. And God provides. And did you know we graduated? Jody graduated her nursing degree at Andrews. I eventually finished the seminary. Got some deferred grades in the way, but I finished the seminary and with not one more penny of debt. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to tell you, according to your faith, young people, be it unto you. The devil has a plan for your money, materialism. God has a plan for your money as well. And that is to put him first, tithe and offering. Since I gave my life to the Lord in 1998, one of the first things the Lord dealt with me was tithing and offering. I wanted to be wealthy. Well, the Lord took that out of my heart. And one of the first things he dealt with me was, are you going to put me first where it counts? I've shared this story with many of you probably in 3 sermons, but bear with me. I was in Japan. I got my first stipend check of $300. And I read in Malachi chapter 3 that if we return 10% tithe, that the Lord will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on you that you can't even contain it. I said, wow, the Lord says 10%. Let's see what he'll do with 50%. And I just put $150 in there and like, all right, let's see. Lord, I trust your word. I've seen you work already. Baby Christian, brand new, just rash. Lord, do it. I want to see it. You said, test me. And I mean, wow. Strangers started walking to my house, just carrying box after box and piling the living room full of boxes of stuff. It was amazing. I'm bouncing all over the place. I remember showing up at one of my first churches in the Carolina Conference. The conference had a budget cut back, and they said, if you come here, you'll have to be a volunteer. I said, a volunteer? I just left Florida Hospital. They were paying me full salary. They were paying my apartment. They were paying my master's degree. I resigned. They wanted me to sign a 10-year contract. I resigned because I wanted to do more evangelism. You guys hired me as part-time, as a Bible worker. That's about $1,500 a month. What do you mean? My U-Haul is in tow. What are you talking about, volunteer? If you come here, you're a volunteer. I said, let me call you back. 3 days later, I called him back. The Lord impressed me with the question, what are you listening to right now? What book are you reading right now? Well, I'm reading a book by George Mueller. That means something to some of you. I'm listening to some cassette tapes. We did that back then. Of David Gates, the mission pilot. The Lord said, go forward. I slept on the church pew for about 2.5 years. It's where I met my wife. You know, guys, if you can meet a woman that will marry you while you're sleeping on a church pew, go for it. Oh. She was a godly woman. She is a godly woman. Praise God. Do you know that I would open up my Bible, I would be praying for money, God help me to make my bills, and I would find $100 bills in my Bible. I would find money under my computer. I remember one day I was sleeping, this is funny, and I'm not up here trying to be a comedian, but I was sleeping in the cradle roll room on an air mattress. I know, it's funny. And one day, I think I'd been up late on a Friday night, like meeting with some students and different church members, and I overslept. And I hear some of the dear old saints coming in, and they're knocking on the door, and they walk into the cradle roll room, and I'm like in my skivvies on my air mattress, and And I'm just rolling up, and they're like, Pastor Jeff, you need to get up. It's time for church. And I'm like, what? Like, what time is it? And I was so embarrassed. I was like, oh my, I got to get out of the church. I got an air mattress. I'd moved from the pew to the air mattress. And I said, and they had kept offering me, stay at our house. But I remember in my training at undergrad, a professor told me, be careful who don't pick favorites in the church because you can upset the balance in the church. So I was like, no, I'll just sleep in the church. But at that morning, I was so embarrassed. I was like, oh, Lord, like this is humiliating. Everybody's got a key to this place. I feel like I live in a fishbowl. I got to get out of here. I mean, not out of the church, but you know what I mean. Like, I gotta find a place to live. And I'm praying, and I'm laying it out before the Lord. And remember, I am returning my tithe. You're like, what are you returning? I was doing some work. I started working for Jody's dad as a construction kind of gopher guy, a helper. And I started doing a little bit of call porting, and I was doing different jobs, odd jobs, cutting grass. And so tithe, offering. And so I'm praying, Lord, your word says you'll supply my every need according to the glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Lord, I'm holding on to Philippians 4:19. You said it, I believe it. It's just a matter of patience. I'm going to wait, and you will provide. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Lord, I delight myself in you. I'm serving you. I'm not chasing the money. I trust that I would like to have my own place. One night, this gentleman, he always reminds me of a mixture between John Wayne, Johnny Cash, and Clint Eastwood. He walked in. He was a drug enforcement officer of the local, the neighboring county. He came in with this slow saunter, and he said, Pastor, I got something for you. And he held out this envelope, and I said, what is it? He said, it's for you. I said, well, Charlie, what is it? He said, it's from my son. I said, well, what is it? He said, open it up. And I opened it up, and it was a check for $6,000. I said, I can't take this, Charlie. And tears are rolling down my face. And I said, Charlie, I can't take this, man. He was a brand new Seventh-day Adventist. He was just giving his heart to the Lord. And he was like, wholehearted. I said, Charlie, I can't take this. He said, you better take it. It's from my boy. I said, I've never met your son. He said, my son said that since I come to this church, I'm a different man, that Jesus is in my heart. And he wants to bless the preacher that's helped me. And I said, Charlie, I don't know what to say. He said, just say thank you and take it. I got me an efficiency. I got my own one-bedroom efficiency. I eventually bought me a little apartment for $28,000. My mortgage payment, or $29,000, my mortgage payment was like $140 a month. I want to tell you, the devil has a plan for your money, but God has a plan for your money as well, and it includes returning a faithful tithe and offering first thing. Amen. And if you will do that, you are going to see God work in your life like you've never seen him work before. You know, the Bible says that if you're not returning tithe, you're robbing God. You know, there's different levels of culpability with crime. You know, if I were to drive by your house and I saw a bike in your front yard and I was, you know, a dishonest unbeliever and I got out and I stole your bike and put it in my trunk, you know what that would be called? Theft. Let's say I'd been doing that for a few years and I'd become a little hardened and more brazen in my stupidity. And I ended up breaking into your house and stealing your Vitamix. You know, or whatever, your DVD player. You know what that would be called? Wouldn't be called robbing. Burglary. Do you know what needs to be present in order for robbery to be designated to a crime? The person needs to be present, and you need to be willing to do them harm. at whatever expense to the person that you're taking from, even if it means hurting them mortally to get whatever you want from them, that's called robbery. And so when Malachi says, and God says in the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verses 7 through 10, God challenges his people. He says, return to me. And his people are like, what do you mean return to you? We never left you, did we? And God says, no, don't even play that. You've left me. Not only have you left me, but you've robbed me. And the people are like, what do you mean we robbed you? What are you talking about, God? You know, that whole playing dumb bit is nothing new. It's been around for a while. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But wherein have we robbed you? He says, in tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse. Ugh. For ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Robbery means, even the secular world understands this, robbery means the person is present and you don't care what happens to the person. Even if they die, you're going to get what you want from that person. That's robbery. And God's saying, that's the attitude of his people when they don't return their tithe and offerings to him. You're robbing me right in my face, and you could care less. And we play games with words like, oh, it's not a test of fellowship, it's a test of, you know, leadership. Look, I challenge you to this afternoon read 1 Corinthians 5 and 6 and see what the Bible says. Extortion. The English Bible uses the word extortion. Extorting is taking money that doesn't belong to you. And just look at what the Holy Spirit says. If you're extorting money and you're a brother in the church, God says something a little more heavy. The God whose name is love, he says some heavy things. And that's not to beat anybody up. It's just to say, look, we got to get wheels on this. You know, I would love... I like cars, but more than cars, I like motorcycles. And I've tried to talk my wife into the benefits of having a motorcycle. I have, and I'm not trying to be a comedian up here. It happens sometimes, it's incidental. But it's true, it's funny, but it's true. But that requires money. I don't need it. I don't need a motorcycle. There's no need for me to have a motorcycle, but I want it. And the Lord's had to deal with me on this subject. If I didn't return tithe in offering, I could go out and make a payment on 2 brand new Harleys. I could. Road King. I could get the leathers. I could make a lot of noise. I could. And it would be a blast. But then I would be set with the issue of, I'm robbing from God. I'm living under a curse from God. And the trade-off, quite frankly, is a no-brainer for me. Because if I were to do that, not only would I be robbing God, but I would be robbing myself of an experience with Jesus. And you can't put a price on that. 2 Harleys, get out of here. In comparison to Jesus. So in closing, Satan does have a plan for your money. It's materialism. But God has a better plan for your money. It includes tithing and offering. I want to challenge you. The Lord is coming soon. And there's going to be a showdown where those who have faith in the Word of God will stand for what's right even though they can't buy and sell anymore. They will have learned to trust in the promises of God's word. They will have gained an experience where they're totally confident in the promises of God's word. That would be now. The curriculum is now. But then there's going to be those who have focused on materialism and they have not followed God's plan for their money. And yeah, they had some cool things. They had some nice things. They had some new things. They robbed God and they robbed themselves of an experience with God. And when the crisis hour hits, crises don't make character, it only reveals character. And so I want to encourage you and gently challenge you that now is the time to follow God's plan for your money. The book, Counsels to Stewardship, says that the absolute most evil sin against God, I was surprised to find this, it's on page 65. The worst sin that we can commit against God is to not return tithe and offering. I was very much surprised by finding this. I'm sorry, it's Counsels to Stewardship, page 86. To defraud God, speaking of tithe and offering, is the greatest crime of which man can be guilty. And yet this sin is deep and widespread. To defraud God is the greatest crime of which man can be guilty, and yet this sin is deep and widespread. I can think of a lot of bad crimes and sins, but this one surprised me. I didn't see that. I didn't, before this study this week, to defraud God of tithes and offerings is the greatest crime of which man can be guilty. Let that set in. No man can serve two masters. He'll love the one or he'll hate the other. Man cannot serve God and money. The devil has a plan for your money, materialism. But God has a plan, a much better plan, tithes and offering. You and I choose what kind of stewards we will be of his resources. If it's your prayer, your desire, Pastor, I'm convicted that I need to be returning a faithful tithe and offering. If that's you, I'm going to invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And with no one else looking on except for heaven above, I'm not even going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm going to ask you to lift your heart up to Jesus silently right now and determine in your heart that you're going to follow God's plan for your money and not the devil's plan any longer. You might have to sell a new car. You might have to change up the budget. You might have to shave some things. You might have to start eating beans and potatoes. You might have to start living more simply and less ostentatiously in some areas. But God has a plan for your money. And if you will put him first with tithes and offerings, he promises to pour out a blessing upon you, open the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing on you so great that you can't even contain it. There's someone here that the Holy Spirit is convicting. I'm going to invite you, as we remain silent, to lift your heart up to Jesus silently, to choose God's plan for your money. Dear Jesus, if you regarded iniquity, who would be able to stand in your presence? But we thank you that you're merciful and willing to forgive those who confess and repent of their sins. Lord, I pray that you would inspire every person here to choose your plan for their money, to return tithes and offerings to you, acknowledging that you're the giver of every good gift. You're the one that supplies brain power and vocational careers and the means whereby we make money. Help us, Lord, to put you first and allow you to give us an experience where we've seen you do just what your word promises you'll do when we put you first and choose your plan for our money. So please, Lord, you know the hearts that have been crying out to you. Please inspire in them a faith in your word. Take away any rebellious spirit. Take away any excuses. Lord, please lead them to submit themselves and to choose your plan for their money. Time is short. We know that the end is here. Please, Lord, do this work in our hearts for your glory. And produce in us a faith that will not waver, even whenever they threaten, you can't buy or sell. What are you going to do? Lord, we'll trust in you and your promises. Help us to that end, we pray. for Christ's sake. Amen. I invite you to stand with me, and as the choristers come forward, we're